Hello everyone, my name is Nathan Mathews and I'm a senior double majoring in accounting and international business. My research project is titled The Trials and Tribulations of John David Provoo. Throughout this presentation, I will recount some of John David Provoo's life during World War II and the ensuing trials. I chose this topic because I am fascinated with history and the criminal justice system. Once I learned about this case from the university archives, I was intrigued about the cases involved and was able to learn more about primary sources while using physical repositories and digital collections. John David Provoo was fluent in Japanese, was a devout Buddhist, and even spent some time in a Buddhist monastery near Tokyo, Japan in 1940. Following his time in Japan, he returned to America and enlisted in the United States Army in 1941, where he was sent to the Philippines. In 1942, he fought in the Battle of Corregidor and was subsequently captured by Japanese soldiers and became a prisoner of war, more commonly known as a POW. In 1945, he was liberated, but that was not the end of his hardships. Once he was back in the United States, he was arrested and charged with treason due to various overt acts as a POW. For example, he was alleged to have caused the death of a U.S. captain, tried to convince a U.S. colonel to turn over U.S. codes, and supposedly beat up a U.S. sergeant to get information about $750 million in silver that was dumped into Manila Bay. Interestingly, the U.S. captain that died due to Mr. Provoo's actions was named Burton Campbell Thompson, nicknamed Stretch, and he was an Iowa State alumnus. It is important to note that a conviction of wartime treason carried the possibility of the death penalty. After 8 months of deliberation and investigation, the court found no proof that he had collaborated with Japanese forces and was honorably discharged. Fascinatingly, 6 weeks after the trial concluded, he re-enlisted in the military. This time, he only lasted 3 years before he was indicted with 7 counts of treason. The trial had over 90 witnesses, including General Jonathan Wainwright, the U.S. commander at Corregidor, although the prosecution only called 15 witnesses to the stand, one of which is pictured on the right and is demonstrating a deep bow that Mr. Provoo would allegedly make when the Japanese soldiers arrived. In 1953, Mr. Provoo was found guilty of 4 acts of treason, including the death of an American officer, and was sentenced to life imprisonment. However, the court reversed the treason conviction because of 3 reasons. Firstly, the court ruled that the trial had been brought in the wrong federal county district. Secondly, there was irrelevant testimony regarding Mr. Provoo's sexuality, which had prejudiced the jury. Lastly, he had spent 5.5 years waiting for a verdict, which meant he was denied his constitutional right to a speedy trial. In addition, this trial was estimated to have cost the government $1 million. Overall, during the whole trial, Mr. Provoo claimed his innocence and that he had only offered his services as an interpreter due to his fluency in Japanese and had only helped, not harmed, his fellow prisoners. While this was the end of Mr. Provoo's treason trials, this was not his last time in a courtroom. In 1957, he was charged with contributing to the delinquency of a minor due to his accompanying and encouragement of a 16-year-old boy who was running away from home. Eventually, he was sentenced to 3 years in the Nebraska Reformatory on a morals charge. All in all, regardless of whether he actively committed treason or not, his life was not the same. And here are my sources. Thank you.